one of you. And by this time, you should have gathered by this time that I'm very fond of my own voice. So I should trouble you a bit. This Alan would not hear of skipping this occasion. And Gold Pandey has made his entry just in time. And he is now truly dispossessed of his subject, namely criminal law and justice. So I suggested he might take intellectual property rights or business law.
Intellectual law,
something like that, or even Yogi Adityanath. Lucknow is taking it, so we can do that. I removed my nameplate, not out of disrespect to the gentleman who put it there. I put it very safely at the back because I don't like things like identity. But the deeper reason, he has the name board, I saw it briefly, saying distinguished professor. Believe me, there is no such thing. I divide human beings into two classes. Those who are distinguished and those who are distinguishable. And I'm that. And so is Astrea. Many of them, all. But we are distinguishable in a special sense. Long time ago, when I came to office in South Gujarat University in Surat, Justice Krishna Iyer, whom I fondly call Krishna, wrote me a letter of congratulations. And then he said, but always remember George Bernard Shaw, who said that the more eminent a person has become, he congratulated me on becoming an eminent person. And you remember, NJSC was partly invalidated, National Judicial Appointment Commission, on the ground of inclusion of eminent persons. I remember Krishna then. So Krishna said, George Bernard Shaw said, and you must remember it, the more eminent a person is, the more she has done things to be ashamed of. Yes. So the more distinguished professor I am, I don't know what it means. Anyway, I wrote down some points, but they are of no value now. Nevertheless, I still first of all begin by saying thank you very much for the exciting conversation. And thank you for fashioning off teachers of criminal law in India, because the consensus that we had in the session before last was that there is no such thing as criminal law. It can never converse with justice. And it's a good thing too. And therefore, Professor Pandey is now divested of his specializing at a very young age, and he'll do any other thing and look forward to an active path. I don't know what Professor Norrie will do, but he might probably work his way through this unconditional love.
I have a very, very serious conversation with Dr. Henrique Carvalho.
So that's very nice. I would like to say a few things in the, my mind goes back to a man called, perhaps you heard his name, called Ivan Illich. And he wrote an excellent book called Medical Nemesis, which is available still, I think, with group of publishers in Delhi, worldwide. And Ivan Illich there said there are two kinds of professions. One is disabling profession, and second is enabling profession. Now, how do we turn that which is disabling into that which is enabling? And his first sentence of the book, Medical Nemesis, was that the greatest, gravest threat there is to human health is medical profession and pharmaceutical industry. So what is the gravest threat of justice? Gravest threat to justice? And I think barring some voices for vipassana and dialogical criminology and law, unconditional law, we have discovered that criminology and law of crimes is a thoroughly disabling profession and will remain so. And we heard that on the law on terror session as well. There is no virtual hope of making it into an enabling profession. So that's perhaps some of you, and you've got a long life ahead of you, might think otherwise and should think otherwise, namely that that which is disabling can still be made enabling in religious category. And good luck to you. Now, I must clarify as a second remark, there was something I said about Eurocentrism. I did not mean in a negative way, but I doubt very much whether there is any such thing as progressive Eurocentrism. Because if you read in Baggio and Zizek, others who are now writing on religion. And I say, I progressive Eurocentric thinkers, according to me, are in a sense post-colonial, but I say they're A to Z, Z thinkers, Agamben to Zizek thinkers. So these progressive Eurocentric thinkers who turn to religion say Christianity is a universal religion. Baggio has a book on St. Paul, and its main thesis in the book is that St. Paul must be remembered, and therefore Jesus must be remembered, Lord Jesus, not for crucifixion was a common occurrence, but St. Paul, who interpreted resurrection as an epochal event. Christ within us lives on. And all the ideas of Derrida, eventually, democracy to come, human rights to come, future to come, everything is to come. Nothing has come, but everything is eventually. This idea is it's a world religion, and it ought to be so. So you might say, if you are less Islamophobic, you might say a new crusade has begun. In a sense. I think my remarks were made long time before the present dispensation. Actually, long time ago. I wrote about the idea of conflict between Dharma Shastra and Artha Shastra in 1965. I'm sorry. Living my age now. You can carbonate me. But I did about Kautilya. I wrote about Manu and Apad Dharma. Apad Dharma is an emergency dharma. And Apad Dharma is very most interesting. It should be interesting to Ratna, if she's not here. Manu had a great problem. In his time, every gurukul, Guru maintained a campus. And gurus normally married young wives. And the disciples were all in love with Guru Patni, the wife of the disciples. The Manu had a problem. And if you read Manu Sruti, he has about 20 pages on 78 types of hell when students covet the guru. So that is, you know, this is there, I'm not joking. It's there. And he said, and each hell was worse than the other. I know which is the worst, but I never eyed any patni, or any pati for that matter. But there are some people who do that. The question before us is how. Not so much my remark about two holy trinities of the Western thought. The question is not to attack or defend any position, but to appreciate the diversity of thought in various human formations, or to use the fighting words of Dipesh Chakraborty, who is a great historian, used to be a great labor historian, he now anthropologist, Anthropocene historian. He has written a book called, the title of which is Provincializing Europe. The question is of how to put everything into its place, even as we think. And we don't do enough of that. It has nothing to do with nationalism or pseudo-nationalism. It's a constant if Eurocentrism is strong, are there any other ways to make it right? And what are those other ways? That is the question. And of course, what is right and what is wrong is a matter of some debate also. So that is my second point. The third point concerns Alan. In fact, everything concerns what he says and does not say. But this particular thing is about love, unconditional love. I was with His Holiness Dalai Lama in a place called, where is this your university? Dehradun. I've gone to address, it is a football stadium, and His Holiness held my hand. I was surprised. I think it's a bad habit, but as a spiritual person, it's a good habit, obviously. And I didn't say anything to him, except in the Hindu way. And Dalai Lama then said to me, son, you're taking dark thoughts. So I said, no. And he said, yes, you're thinking, aren't you thinking about Pol Pot? And I was thinking when I met him to ask him a question. The question was, at that time the Buddhist monks had marched throughout the city of Pompeii, I can't pronounce it well, in Cambodia, for protesting against the proposed war crime tribunal against Pol Pot, who killed as many people or more in genocide worse than Hitler. And there's Skull Museum in Cambodia. The skulls are there, you can see the skulls. And I wanted to ask this man, Buddhist man, saying what he thought about it. But he didn't say a word, he read my mind. My wife does occasionally. I said, how do you know, sir? How do you know? He said, I have an answer for you. And maybe I've been sent by Lord Buddha to give an answer. I said, what is the answer, sir? By this time I was more incoherent than usual. And I said, what is the answer? I should not have asked him the question. He said, you would have to take, this happened, you would have to take several births and rebirths to understand why Buddhist monks marched through the city in Cambodia, capital of Cambodia. And I said, why? I was not blabbering, idiot. So I said, why, sir? He said, because the notion of Buddhist karma is something you cannot understand in one life. So I want to say to Alan that unconditional love is infinite justice, as I said. Not in this generation, not in next generation, not in generation after that, mother, grandmother, mother, daughter. But after daughter, it is infinite justice. I have nothing against infinite justice. I have, in fact, in Anthropocene, I have done an article last year on long article on Anthropocene justice. And I think there is some merit in infinite justice. And in infinite justice, in Dalai Lama's words, to that effect, killing does not appear as killing. Karuna Forgiveness, compassion of a dying person is what you should. Karuna is this notion. It's not mercy. It's maybe it's compassion, untranslatable, Karuna. And he said, you should understand Karuna. So I think we should understand forgiveness, perhaps as such, as Karuna in a Buddhist tradition, evoking infinite justice. My time is up. I have a couple of more points, but I'll stop here. But before I stop, I would say to some people who presented very nice papers, and generally I think the discussion remained inconclusive. But we ought to distinguish between two things. Between what my friend Werner Kappand in Bonn suggests is a sociologist as well as a person who works on aesthetic theory. Werner Kappand always talks about validity cultures. And he's a body of person in some senses. He said passion and law. What is common between passion and law? One is normative, other is non-normative. Passions you can change without having to be risen. And that was Herbert Hart's point about criticizing objects, about habit of obedience. I won't go there. So I think, what is the difference between what judges do or think they have to do and what the critics think what they have to do? In what does the difference lie? That's the point made about critique and criticism. The point about critique is you always think about alternatives to the present system. And that's why forgiveness, metanoma forgiveness, or metanoma unconditional love appears. There was no beyond the talk of guilt. I appreciate that. So I end roughly where I've begun. I think we ought to distinguish, should law develop other cultures than validity cultures? Should law develop a dialogic culture? When I was in, just 2 minutes, in Budapest, I was in the pre-revolutionary or counter-revolutionary matter of choice, but before 75. In Budapest, the room of this size, there were 8 Supreme Court judges. Budapest is this, Hungary is the size of Haryana, state of Haryana, very small. There are 65 Supreme Court justices. And I was taken to a trial where a Roma person was guilty of sexual harassment. And as the deputy chief justice of Hungary said, I have translated in use of English, the trial was going on. The boy, young man was brought in, but before he was being brought in, he expressed desire to smoke. The police released his fetters and gave a cigarette and he smoked. The three of them, deputy vice presidents, were addressed by the grandmother, grandparents, parents, and sisters of families of each side. The judges then addressed the person concerned and said, this is not good socialist citizenship. You should behave better. Undoubtedly you have committed a crime, which is grave. We sent you for 3 years imprisonment, but you will be looked after by the state. That was paternalism according to liberal theories. So they gave a socialist dose of education. And what is more, they came, the families of the person who was sentenced to jail, the families of the complainant, and the three, all the Supreme Court judges, and I boarded the same tram to go to our separate destination. This is socialist justice. My simple point I end here is that we have only talk of liberal criminals. Maybe socialist jurisprudence of some of you is history, or not even history. But socialist jurisprudence knew what was dialogical justice, criminal justice system. By the Soviet Union, by Hungary, by Poland, It may be a matter of history. We all become a part of mob culture now, including Gaiden. But I think there is merit in revisiting socialist communal law and justice systems. And to what extent, to what we can learn from participating justice that socialists tried with. Paternal resistance is what we started. I'm talking. You're very kind.
I'm sure I can find some forgiveness. Okay, so Professor Pandey, would you like to?
No. After Ellen, I will make
okay.
A comment.
Okay, so. Why after
Ellen?
We'll say the final word.
Last word.
Final word. Okay, so.
Well, first of all, I'd like to say, you know, how much I've really enjoyed the seminar over the last couple of days, and very grateful to NLUD for sponsoring it, and it's been great to come along and sort of meet new people and also sort of meet old friends as well, and to have what I think has been a really productive dialogue. I think, you know, we started off with the idea of, I suppose we had two goals in mind. One goal was to talk about and start and initiate a process that has, I think, gone on in the past, but doesn't seem to go on quite so much now, of thinking about critical theory and criminal justice in India. And you know, there's some wonderful books like the book that we were looking at earlier on this morning by Professor Ranbir Singh and Kalpana
Kandia.
You know, there have been wonderful books published already, and I remember a few years ago I was at the Critical Legal Conference, which is a sort of a peripatetic conference. Basically, it's a British conference, but it was held in Hyderabad about 10 years ago, something like that, at which you were at, and we talked then. And you know, that was a very lively conference, so the resources have always been available in the Indian context for a critical law, critical legal, and especially critical criminal justice engagement and development of an understanding of criminal law from that point of view. I think from that point of view, all that we've done maybe is to help to relight the fire through having this engagement. So that was the first thing. And then the second thing was to really to sort of explore a little bit in dialogue what the critical realist tradition is in relation to thinking about criminal justice. And it's a minority pursuit in the UK to be a critical realist, but at the same time I think it has important things to say. I think it has important things to say because it can both talk in the old historical, I say the old, I hope it's not too old, but the language of history, of Marxism, of social and political struggle, of structure, of the structures of the world that tend to get forgotten about in the neoliberal environment. It can talk about those things, but it can also talk about things like fluidity, difference, conflict, dialectic. It can talk about those things. It can talk about postmodern complexity. Because it has in its dialectical form, it frames things in a very fluid way. It doesn't have, it's open to categories in the world. That's the realist point. It's open to an understanding of the world. So if the world shows fluidity and difference and strange things happening culturally and historically and politically, then critical realism is a place for those, which is an intellectual approach that should be and is open to understanding those things. So the realist approach, I think, is quite important from that point of view. But then also, it's developed more a sense of the metaphysical in relation to these things, in ways that I think other traditions have also come to in various ways. So there are some strengths in critical realism. There are no doubt some weaknesses in critical realism as a tradition. There are a degree of commonalities with other critical approaches, and I think that really the important thing is, as Upen said, you know, to appreciate the diversity of thought, and this is where the realist point is valid. I think is to say that, you know, if we all live in a world where it's possible for us all to come together and talk and to understand what each other is saying, then that's already a realist understanding of that world. You're already part of a critical realist embrace. And then our theoretical approaches, our different theoretical approaches, become ways of sharing thoughts about how we understand the world. But, you know, we're not in doubt, I think, that, you know, we live in a world where criminal justice takes certain forms. We're not in doubt that torture is a real problem in the Indian context. We're not in doubt about the continuing significance of gender in terms of the ways that it is not properly addressed by all our societies. All these things we have in common, and so it then becomes a question of talking across our different theoretical traditions and seeing what we can learn from each other. On that score, I think I would just make a comment, which is that it's been made very clear, I think, that there are different kinds of historical trajectories. You know, we know that in India, it appears anyway that from what people have said here, that in India, the law and the state have remained actually rather similar over the last 40 or 50 years, from the time of Congress politics through to the BJP, through to the crisis around after 9/11. Through all those things, it appears that the Indian legal framing of these things has not changed that much. And I asked Mrinal that question yesterday, and he basically said that was so the state had remained rather similar as a matter of emphasis and so on. Historically, things have been a bit different in the West because, you know, the move from, I'm not saying there aren't huge continuities, but within those continuities, especially with regard to criminal justice, there's also significant change from the days of social democracy and the welfare state through to the days of neoliberalism, the politics of identity, and increasingly a sense of the politics of community. There have been real changes there. Basically, the hollowing out of the welfare state, the falling back of social democracy, has left us with a kind of a more authoritarian democracy than we had previously, and so we've seen what are really quite big differences in terms of, for example, the way that terrorism is dealt with in law now from the way it was dealt with in the 1970s. But as I say, the historical trajectory in India, it appears like, you know, the modern neoliberal nationalistic corrupt India is not that different in legal terms from the previous post-independence Congress governed India. At least that's what I'm hearing. So we've got different historical trajectories, but that doesn't stop us from actually having the conversations about the differences between us. Far from it. It actually makes it genuinely comparative project that we can have, where we look at at the different contexts. You know, we're law and context scholars. We look at the different contexts and we chart the differences, and we see how we help understand, help each other understand how our worlds work through that. And from that point of view, I thought there would be perhaps more of a sense of the deeper history, of course, is the history of an imperial centre and a colony. That's the deeper history. But that I don't feel that that has really affected us most in terms of the conversations that we've had. The main theoretical underpinnings have been, you know, we share our theoretical underpinnings. So, I mean, there's been quite a lot of sharing around psychoanalysis, for example, at the conference, and that doesn't seem to have been affected by the centre, periphery, however you want to put it, nature of the historical relationship between us. There have been some suggestions that, you know, I'd like to engage more with the idea that there are significant differences, but I, at the moment I'm not entirely sure what they would be. It seems to me that, you know, we do live in different worlds, in the sense that, you know, the things that affect us, the ways in which the social and economic and political regimes pan out within a general neoliberal framing, is such that there are differences, but there seems to be really no problem in talking commonly about the things that preoccupy us. I think Upen's point about no progressive Eurocentrism is a valid one. This links up with what I've just said. I think that's a valid point. You know, that in the sense that much of our knowledge is Eurocentric. But at the same time, I think that we should be careful not to overstate that. And I think what is true for the species is true for the species. And we have to understand that what we are as a species, we have to understand our different historical contexts. And insofar as Eurocentrism is captured in traditional ways of understanding law, liberal ways of understanding law in particular, then Eurocentrism is a problem. But the critique of Eurocentrism is something that happens in the European centre, as well as happens in the what used to be the colonies, now the neo or the post-colonial settings. And speaking as someone who does live and work in the European centre, you know, I'm struck by the need to live as best we can in that setting. You know, we live lives where we try to do the best. We try to think through what it means to live a moral life, and that's obviously not always very easy. And being a distinguished professor, as Upen says, probably makes it harder rather than easier in the long run. But even in those kind of settings, we try to do the best we can, and we try to understand what it means to be a human being in the world. And I just finish on this point, which is that one of the ways of doing this is to think about, well, what, you know, there's history. There's what history makes of us. Now, what's the additional things that we have that are not history? Okay, we can't just be history. We can't just be social construction. And I think the additional things that we have can be talked about in terms of something like love. And there, you know, we find ourselves in commonality again. You know, Upen talks about unconditional love and infinite justice, and that's something that we, you know, is a long time coming. I think the way that I'd like to put it is slightly differently. I'd like to put it in terms of, you know, how, if there is a sense of the unconditional, a sense of the planet and the planets and the and humankind and the other animal species within on a particular planet, in a particular system of planets. And if within all that there is a sense of the unconditional and the infinite, and if even if we approach the infinite in according to very different understandings and traditions for that, the thing that I think we all try and do is we don't just think, well, that's something that will come eventually, you know, kingdom come or whatever the, you know, whatever the nirvana or whatever. We don't just think in terms of that end state when everything looks better, but we've gone through a lot of misery in the meantime. But it's rather about living life in the light of infinite justice. You know, we're on the planet for 70 years or whatever it is, and we're pushed in all sorts of directions, but there's more to what we are than just being pushed in those directions. And actually thinking through that sense of living life in the light of an infinite justice, something that's in one sense deferred all the time, but another sense is always here and with us now, and should inform the ways in not just as a matter of deferral, but should inform the ways in which we do things as best we can, seems to me to be the way in which we should go. So the unconditional is bound up with our transactions, as I said in my paper. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Alan. So we turn over to Mr. Pandey for the...
I think we, where Alan ended, we end with a sense of satisfaction. What we dreamt about a year back, that we should have a critical legal theory workshop in India with British scholars and Indian scholars. That has come true, and we have had 2 days scintillating sessions, 8 sessions in 2 days, in which as many as first day 10 papers, second day 9 papers, and 21 presentations were there. In all, it was a very substantial.
Yes.
I could never imagine that this kind of success could be achieved. It's very satisfying. And in which I had myself doubts when we were structuring the workshop, I requested Alan that we should have on the first day, half the day should go with British scholars who tell us about the theory of critical thought. Then the Indian presentations would come. But Alan thought the other way, and he was right, I was wrong. In session 4, in session 6, in session 7, Craig came in session 4, in session 6, Henrique came, and in session 7, Alan himself came. And he intermingled with the Indian scholars, and that made the presentations and the deliberations much richer than what they would have ordinarily been. They would have been one-sided, they would have been Indian side only, and the two sides would have remained apart. Now they have come together, and I think this is a great satisfying moment, I feel this is a great success of this workshop, for which I think all of us deserve, because the participants sustained the whole thing. The number of participants never went down from what it is at the moment. It was almost the same right on the first day till the last day. And I think I end up again with Alan, transition, and is all about transactions. And unconditional love does not come alone. It is because we also sacrificed our comforts, our siesta, and our peaceful individual existence. We gelled together and made the workshop a great success. Thank you very much, Alan and Henrique and Craig, all the three of you. Thank you very much once again. We were Indian team anchors, and I think Professor Bakshi was a great resource. Some of your presentation, young people, they give us a lot of hope, because there are some young presentations, young scholars who are really are going to take this critical theory studies seriously, and I would only say that those studies should focus more on the context and social political realities of the society. I'm worried about few developments that are taking place. One development is that people's morality seem to be overwhelming the moral legal content, which is very sad. It happened in respect of juvenile justice law change. It happened, it's happening in the event, in the course of events like lynching of cow lynchers, Gauraksha lynching. All this is a bad sign. And fascination for draconian punishments, as if draconian punishments is the be all and end all of our existence. And if they were there, we would have no problem. And they have been there for the last 4 years, and we still have problems. Therefore, it is an illusion, a maya, which has not served us. We must be guarding against this, and authoritarian, reversal back to the authoritarian frame of government, and not liberal. We are getting away from liberal model, which is a change, which Alan said there was no change, but we are moving towards authoritarianism in all modes. This is little worrying, but we hope we'll overcome this situation in the course of time.
Share this thing that I'm also thinking that how can it be taken forward in terms of sustaining on what we have done. So I would welcome that if any idea you have, because we are, as I said, we are also now in the process of introducing a paper on critical criminal law at LLM. In fact, we have already done, and we are also engaged, and we are actually contemplating a research project. So I will look forward your comment. I will soon circulate a kind of a small draft. And my idea is that how we can utilize these perspectives in understanding those socio-political realities which Professor Pandey mentioned. To what extent those socio-political realities in India could be explained through these important frameworks. So that would, I think, bring a very important blending and a kind of very interesting fusion between the two, one pure academic and another is more practical and science. So there is a need. And Professor Pandey, right in the beginning, has also mentioned that the Indian legal canvas is quite divided of this kind of thinking and this kind of. And I don't know why it is not happening, though we have a full jurisprudence, teaching in all our courses, but I think critical legal studies forms only a small, it is always taught in the end, I don't know. So by the time the course is completed and everybody is in hurry. So I think it has to be, taken more seriously. And I wish that those who are connected with law schools, they can think of floating a special paper or a special seminar course on some of these aspects.
to be more precise, and because young scholar, as sir is saying, Hope, and a lot of people are taking interest, so I think there should be some source to, you know, tap that kind of interest among these students, and also, you know, some teaching and research particularly in this area. Like, not much research is being seen in this particular area. Nobody is interested to do any research in pure critical legal, you know, theories and all that. So I think some pure research is missing in law. That is something crisis. So from their doing, that's what I'm saying. So some hope is there that this momentum and this, you know, the entire this approach must be encouraged. That some, at least we always, because I always feel in law school that what is the practical relevance of this? I said the fundamental function of the universities is to create original knowledge. That cannot happen unless you have some fundamental and pure research on our domain and on our subjects. So there is a kind of rush amongst the student and the, even the teachers to become advocates kind of people. So it's not a great thing to become advocate. It's very important to be jurist to some extent. I don't know, I have certain discussion with my colleagues that for a student it is good that after 5 years they will become advocate. But teacher, if the teachers start behaving like judges and advocate, then there is a serious damage to the scholarship in our field. So I think this workshop has given us a lot of you know, ideas which must be pursued in terms of small writings. And I would also call upon that the National Law University Journal is now coming in a different shape. Sage Publication is going to publish our journal. We have recently, you know, tied up with them. So I think if one of the issues, if Professor Bakshi and Professor Pandey can guide, we can have a full issue devoted on critical legal studies in one of the issues. So that can also be one of the ways to promote this entire momentum that we had. And I'm sure that this is edition one, and I'm sure that we will soon try to meet on a similar platform in some other way, in some other form, and in a different format. So this is going to be continued. I take this opportunity to thank all of you who have assembled. And I have bothered you, you know, quite. We have a series of men. Alan, sometimes it was confusing. He is also writing. Mr. Pandey is also writing. Me also writing. But I appreciate your patience and deadlines that we wanted you to keep. But in the end, you see, this is the outcome which came. And it is because of your response. And can we think of, you know, developing this paper into kind of some volume or something? If let us you know, create this, because you have already submitted certain papers. So can we make use of these papers at some stage in terms of bringing out a kind of volume and to put it to best use? Because that is my thinking. We can discuss it through email. So thank you very much. Professor Allen and Henry and Craig, and of course all my invited guests, Dennis and Latika, Amit, everybody, and Juwali Tikku, and everybody, a lot of people, Professor, you know, everybody is there. So I'll take this opportunity. Thank you, one and all. See you soon. Thank you.